Hey guys, so this video we're going to talk about mid-poly workflow, and we're getting started here in Cyberpunk because this environment is just loaded with mid-poly models. So if you were to walk around and look at anything in this game, you'll quickly discover that almost virtually all of these models, for the most part, have some kind of chamfer to the edges on them. And this is kind of the key part of creating mid-poly models. You chamfer the edges, and this allows you to use weighted normals, right? And so then you can maintain the shading across the model very easily. It's going to stay relatively simple in the process, but you can start to just use various materials to kind of fill in the model there. So they're seamless textures, generally speaking, but these models will share textures across each other, basically. So that texture here for concrete might be used somewhere else, et cetera, et cetera. Now, it gets spiced up a little bit, or a lot of bit anyways, with using mesh decals and also projected decals. So projected decals are usually used on maybe larger things a lot of times, perhaps, such as the buildings, the road, whatever the case. But mesh decals and sometimes projected decals can get placed on props as well and whatnot. So you can see the bench here is it's relatively simple. There's nothing crazy going on with that, so they're very fast and easy to make. The information Kaizik or advertisement or whatever that is, also very easy to make. If you use box cutters and bullions and hard ops, these things happen very fast. And something like this maybe take a little bit longer, but it's not that bad either. Alright, so let's go ahead and jump over to Blender then. And we're just going to take a look at just a couple examples here. I'll turn off that audio in the background there. So here's the trick. I went ahead and kind of recreated the bench a little bit. So first, the base model, something like this. It's really nothing crazy. The only trick is you want to chamfer all the edges. So the reason for this is going to, of course, be that that allows you to use weighted normals. So if you had a regular cube and you add a bevel modifier to it, use one segment, you do something like this. The bevel modifier, of course, you're probably going to set one segment, 0.5. You can use angle on more cubic things, but a lot of times you're going to want to switch to weight, which we'll play with in a second. Clamp overlap, probably want to turn that off. Loop slide, you can try toggling on or off depending on the results you're getting. You want to set outer emitter to arc usually, especially if you have concave corners, which we don't have right now, but you definitely want to make sure if you have like little triangles in your corners there, you use arc instead and it'll kind of spread them out to an N-gon or whatever. Now, after you set it to chamfer, you just use a weighted normal, right? So when we do this, we use keep sharps and face influence. Now, the reason you want to use keep sharps is some things may still just not need to be chamfered, and you might mark it sharp, all right? So there's no reason not to do that if you don't need, like, if you can, you know, do it, why not? Certain things like the base of the object, like, obviously, you might not need to chamfer it. So face influence, on the other hand, is a little bit trickier, which we'll get into here in just a sec. So we'll start with this. When we go into edit mode on this object, there's something called split normals, and this is what controls your shading normally. So if this was shaded auto smooth, shaded flat, you would have split normals like that, something like that. When we take this bevel here and we apply it, what we'll find is we get this kind of a result with shade smooth and or shade auto smooth at 180 anyways. And this is not really what you want either. So when you add this weighted normal, it's going to look like this, right? But these still aren't up and down maybe the way you want them to go. You could try changing this option here, the weight. You could straighten them out more possibly, but this could mess up some curves. So usually leaving it at 50 works out pretty well. And then grabbing the faces here with face influence, you can hit Alt-N, set face strengths to strong. By default, they're all medium, but you can see what happens when I set them strong, right? It straightens those out even more. And that's what you want. You want to have control like that, perhaps. All right. So normally these objects, by the way, you're going to shade auto smooth, set it to 180. If you're in Blender 4.1 or newer, perhaps, you just have to hit shade smooth usually, and it'll still work and behave like auto smooth would anyways. So that out of the way, you now have control over this. Eventually, you can go through, you can UV map everything as you normally would, where you place seams. And because it is a chamfer, you might place it on one side or the other. Usually, whatever, like the expected side this is to be viewed from, you would probably place the seams in areas where it's at a glancing angle or just completely hidden, like the backside or something. And so just go through and start unwrapping your objects, right? And you can see they don't get too crazy here. Let's do material preview. They're not really that crazy at, like, necessarily by themselves. It's when you start dressing them up with decals, things become a little bit more interesting. So how you create decals is really up to you. You can create decals in Blender, Substance Painter. You can do it in Substance Designer. You can, of course, pretty much do it anywhere. You want to do it in Photoshop or, you know, there's tons and tons of ways of doing that to create decals, right? And so that's not what this video is about, unfortunately, but you create some decals. You basically create them as a set. I did these ones here in Blender, with the exception of the warning piece, which I did real quick in Affinity Designer. So, and this is using a add-on called GrabDoc. This is free on GitHub, I think, but the other places you might have to pay for it. So you can set this up and use GrabDoc by clicking Setup Scene. It's going to generate this plane with the arrow here, arrows up. And then all you got to do is lay mesh in front of this. And it could be textured mesh even, right? Click Leave Cam on Exit so you can do these previews. Like if you want to do a normal preview, you can bake out normal maps. These are camera projections. So it's just a camera looking down at what you've created here and doing like an EV render, I think even. And then you can export to a certain directory, set a name, and use PNG 16-bit if you want instead of resolution. So you can create something like that very fast. Re-import that into Blender using the Image as Planes add-on. When you install that Image as Planes add-on, you'll be able to go to Image, Shift-A, Create Image, Image as Planes, and then you'll be able to load up your decal. It'll come in as a plane. You can cut it up, start doing some loop cuts or whatever, and then start separating things out. Set the origins to geometry, maybe optimize it a bit. And now you should be able to do face project, median, align rotation to target, and also use local. So now you can take things like that, shift E, hold control, and you can move them around. Hit RZ now, since we're using the local orientation. This should work out just fine. It has to be done off this plane though, like that. You can start to place these things around, scale them. You can move them out slightly if you have Z fighting and do things like that. Now, of course, when you're creating decals for Game Engine, however you set up your decals in the Game Engine, you might use these differently on your models while you're creating them here in Blender. So for example, you might have like a an offset bias on mesh decals perhaps. So that way it renders in front of other things in the scene perhaps a little bit by pushing it a couple pixels forward or something like that, right? So you might even intersect these, like where they're literally laying one on top of the other here in Blender, but in something like Unreal Engine or Unity, it might be able to be offset, and then you can pull it forward a little bit so you don't have to always drag these forward unless you want to do that here in Blender. Just keep that in mind. There's little shader tricks in the game engines. But other than that, yeah, you know, this is basically a slightly modified cube, chamfered, UV mapped real quick, seamless texture tossed onto it, just so like a regular material with a texture that's seamless. It could be a PBR material, save you a lot of trouble, right? Do some decals, and if you want to create these kind of like trim decals, if you would, you can make these off of your mesh. You just add a couple, or you know, add a loop cut where you need it. If you can create a loop, you can duplicate that out, separate it, and now you can go through and re-unwrap this to the decal, right? So I've already done that. It's already unwrapped. You can see here. Let's turn those off real quick. And you can see it's just using that like a trim sheet, right? That's pretty much it. That's all you need to do there. So later on, you can go back and on your base mesh, at least, you can just dissolve that back out. Not a big deal. Control exit. That's that. So your models can stay relatively simple. You can make all kinds of cool labels and extra details here. And you can make these do other different things in Game Engine that you can't really do here in Blender, perhaps. At least not easily without setting up a really crazy shader thing. But and then, you know, you put a little bit more time into your models, and this is where you end up with that whole cyberpunk look rather quickly, because you can do any number of different kinds of trims that have just normal detail information in it, perhaps, or ambient occlusion in normals, or there's any number of ways to set up decals, right? But the mid-poly workflow overall, that's all it is. It's just a very bare bones kind of base mesh with interesting stuff added to the top of it or the surface of it, and mixing the materials up a little bit. So you might use, just a dozen, or not a, not even a dozen. You might just use like two or three maybe materials with decals, and that's it. And these decals can be shared across multiple assets in different parts of the environment. And these base materials as well can also be utilized wherever needed in other parts of the environment as well. Just a reminder that most game engines, they either do something called batching, or they do GPU instancing. And it, in the case of like static mesh and stuff like that, a lot of times when the GPU renders the mesh, what it's doing is it's rendering everything by like material as opposed to rendering things by object, right? So it's going to be all like materials as one pass or one draw or whatever. And then it's going to do the same for the other stuff, something along those lines. Anyways, it gets more technical than that. But so when you set all that up, though, you have it all pretty much going the way it needs to go. You'll be able to export these out to your game engine at some point and be able to just simply use them wherever you need to. So I had to change my orientation back to global and median on that one. But you'll be able to start doing level design with it at that point, right? Because it's pretty much good to go. So maybe we have like a bus stop thing going on over here. I should have parent those, but I did not. So we're going to parent all of this to the base, if I can get a hold of all of it. Control P, object keep transformation. So I can now grab just the base. I don't have to worry about all the extra. Oh, this one went for the ride. Alt P, clear object, parent. Okay, that, there we go. We got some other stuff apparently going crazy. I'm not sure what or how those got out there. Got some kind of mirror on these, yeah. That's because I borrowed them from the bench. So, is there any more out there? There's something out there. Why is it so far away? All right, it's got to be one of these. Or two of them. All right, so I just wanted to move that back over. Like maybe it's like a an advertisement, you know, for a bus stop or something like that. And we'll move those over too, why not? All right, so you see how it starts to become a little bit more convincing when you do this, right? If you take your time with it, it'll definitely be better than this, but that's the process. That's the idea. That's the whole thing about Cyberpunk and many other titles out there, like Star Citizen, for example. They just, they're making use of mid-poly workflow. It's a very fast, efficient way of working, and it's fun. To be honest, it's just super simple. So anyways, that's it. You can do this on anything that's more or less static mesh, but you can do it on vehicles too. So if you want to do this for like spaceships or whatever, just use chamfers everywhere if you needed to. Not a big deal. But yeah, that's pretty much it for this video. That's mid-poly workflow in a nutshell, and I'll check you out in the next one. All right, take care.